and the entire San Francisco Bay Area. You're watching KTEH in San Jose, Channel 54, with programs made possible by community support.
When a prominent black joins the Republican Party, it becomes a national news story. Ask me, I should know. But it wasn't always that way. As a matter of fact, at one time, the Democratic Party was the all-white party of state-enforced segregation and slavery. The Republican Party was organized in 1854 to oppose the expansion of slavery. Republicans in Congress initiated the 13th Amendment, which outlawed slavery, the 14th Amendment, which guaranteed black citizenship, and the 15th Amendment, which extended the right to vote to former slaves. How did we arrive at today's perception by most blacks that Republican equals racist? 40% of black voters voted for Dwight Eisenhower in 1956, and 32% cast their ballots for Richard Nixon in 1960. But by 1988, just 1% of the votes cast in the Republican presidential primaries were cast by blacks. Did blacks leave because they found a better home, or were they intentionally run out? I'm Tony Brown. In a moment, is there a conspiracy to keep blacks out of the Republican Party?
Tony Brown's Journal is brought to you by Pepsi and its bottlers. This program is part of Pepsi-Cola's continuing support of your community's cultural, educational, and business interests.
Our guest on this program is Mr. Matthew Rees. Mr. Rees, you have a soon-to-be-published book, which you were kind enough to let me peruse your unpublished manuscript. Now, what is the name of your book?
From the Deck to the Sea, Blacks and the Republican Party.
Now, From the Deck to the Sea, is that from a quote from Ralph Bunche?
No, that's a quote by Frederick Douglass, who said on numerous occasions, the Republican Party is the deck, all else is the sea.
And that means what?
I think it reflected Douglass's belief that the Republican Party in the 19th century was really, it was the party that had freed the slaves. It was the party that opposed the extension of slavery. It was the party that whose representatives in Congress following the Civil War during the Reconstruction period had engineered the passage of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, which, as you noted, outlawed slavery and gave blacks citizenship and voting rights. It was clear that the party was much more in tune with the interests of the black population in the 19th century than was the Democrats. One example being in 1884, when Grover Cleveland was elected president, this being 21 years after the Emancipation Proclamation had been issued, there was a fear that blacks would be re-enslaved. And it's a telling example of just what the Democrats thought of blacks and how they wanted to deal with them in the 19th century. I think the Republican Party following 1877 forgot its original mission and clearly had abandoned the black population.
Which party was that now?
By 1877, the Republican Party had also abandoned the black population, and I don't think you could really ever say for the 19th century that the Democrats had taken any interest in blacks.
Now, what we call black Reconstruction, called Reconstruction, from roughly 1867 to 1877, mm-hmm. during which blacks had more political power before or since in America, that was instigated by some of the radical Republicans, Senator Thad Stevens in particular, which really, in fact, empowered blacks. Ironically, that period was ended by a Republican president who betrayed blacks. What was that president's name?
That was Rutherford Hayes. And the situation arose in the 1876 election where there was a dispute as to the outcome, and Hayes in the an ill-fated compromise of 1877 agreed to withdraw federal troops from the South who had been placed there ostensibly to protect the rights of blacks. They were removed, and in return Hayes was named president. And that essentially ended Reconstruction, and there was no, it would be hard pressed to say that there was any attention from a presidential administration for blacks from that time until 1936.
And 1936 is Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
When Roosevelt entered office, what was important about that was this was during the period of the Great Depression, and blacks had suffered disproportionately relative to the rest of the nation. And Roosevelt, who was no civil rights liberal, but he came in with a program offering jobs, and was really, as I said, he was the first president that blacks could look to as a friend in the White House, really since Abraham Lincoln. So you're talking about a period of almost 75 years in which blacks really had no one fighting for their rights in the federal government. And Roosevelt came in offering jobs, and that's what led to the massive migration of blacks from the Republican Party. Herbert Hoover in 1932, a Republican, had received approximately 70% of the black vote, but that was turned in 36, and Roosevelt received approximately 70% of the black vote, and it's a pattern that has continued up to the present day.
And I might say it exploded with Lyndon Johnson as president.
Absolutely.
He became the best friend in the White House blacks have ever had.
Absolutely.
Passed more comprehensive civil rights legislation, the Voting Rights Act, 1965.
Absolutely.
And from that point on, and with Goldwater introducing the Southern Strategy, which I want to get to, what was that, roughly 1964?
That was the 64 election.
So we essentially have a Republican Party from 1854, when it was founded, to stop the expansion of slavery, which was rather progressive in terms of racial inclusion.
Oh, absolutely.
Until approximately 1964, when Goldwater introduced the Southern Strategy, and that is playing on the fears of Southern whites about race and racism. So we got two parties, basically, in vis-a-vis black people, do we not?
Well, I think there's no question that in 1964 there was not a great effort to win the black vote, and Goldwater was seeking to exploit some of the nation's racial fears. I think the message that needs to be delivered for the contemporary period, because I think it's the most important one, is the economic message related to the Republican Party. And one of the things that I have written about is the fact that during the 1980s, you had a period in which you had a 92-month economic expansion, the longest period of economic expansion in United States history, and the black population made greater gains than the population at large. You had a 16% increase in black family income. You had a 30% increase in black civilian employment, a 30% increase in black employment in white-collar jobs. You had an 8% annual growth rate for black businesses, and you had, despite the fact that the blacks only represented 11% of the workforce, you had them gaining 15% of the jobs. I think that's the untold story of the 1980s. It was truly boom time for black America, and I think it's very unfortunate that Ronald Reagan and the Republican Party is repeatedly vilified as somehow representing interests that are inimical to the black population, because the interests, I think, of black politicians and black leaders today and the black population at large should be on economics, because I think it's the economic barriers that are the barriers to equality today. I don't feel that the legal barriers are should be the emphasis.
Now, Mr. Reese, if I may go back and add a nuance to your statement about black progress. The period that you outline in your numbers, based on what I know, are correct, but I'm sure you're familiar with a study that was just released by Population Center that documented the fact that during this period of economic explosion and black progress, that the most black affluent families, black families earning over $50,000, doubled. During the same period, blacks living in poverty, 30%, remain constant. So what we have seen during this period of affirmative action and other social programs is that the black middle class has benefited tremendously, but these programs have not been translated to the poor blacks. So while you can say this advancement has been fantastic for the black community, it has been fantastic for the middle class segment of the black community.
You're absolutely right. I think there is a realization among senior members of the Republican Party right now that that the party hasn't done enough to address the needs of the poor and the black poor. The goal now is to give, of the, among some members of the Republican Party, is to give the poor a hand up and not a hand out. And you see it, you see there's a program in the, coming out of the administration now. It's an empowerment scheme based on removing bureaucratic bureaucratic barriers and unleashing the talents that can exist among poor people. And you've got programs like school choice and tenant management and enterprise zones. And it's something that's being led by Jack Kemp at the Secretary of HUD, and I think it's it addresses some of the fundamental concerns that are now looked at as the failures of the Great Society.
Are you not in logic mm-hmm. falling into the trap of advocating government? And isn't that precisely what the Republicans say won't work?
Now, because I think what these programs are based on is getting government out of the way and unleashing some of the some more private sector
and
initiatives and individual initiatives and not government-imposed initiatives. And I think if you start to treat poor people like rational human beings, then I think they will respond as rational human beings do and take advantage of the opportunities that are made available to them. I think there is some agreement today that the programs that were developed under the Great Society did not do enough to emphasize the individual.
I'd like to get back to your book, mm-hmm. Another aspect of your book. In it, you point out, I think, roughly from 1936 to 1964, mm-hmm. about 35% of the black population voted for the Republican.
It was 65-35 Democrat-Republican.
Yeah. Yeah, and 65 were voting for the
Democrats.
For the Democrat.
Yeah.
Now, we have not had in the history of blacks, we were all Republicans at one time, then now we're all voting for the Democrats. Mm-hmm. But that's the only period we've ever had mm-hmm. where blacks were represented in terms of both parties. What was the outcome of blacks having a foot solidly planted in both parties?
It was invaluable in terms of spurring candidates and office holders to take positive action in areas of civil rights. With this clear competition for the black vote, it was a message to these people, ranging from it was FDR, it was Truman, it was Eisenhower, it was Kennedy, and it was Johnson. It was a message to them that they could not afford to overlook the black vote because it would be critical to their election. In 1960, Richard Nixon lost the election because he did not receive more of the black vote. And it's
1960
in the 1960 election, and it was that competition for the black vote which spurred these people to take action. And I think until the black vote it's break this 9-to-1 barrier, their black voter concerns are not going to be listened to seriously because both parties can write off the vote. The Republicans say to themselves, well, we know we're not going to get the black vote, so we're not going to try for it. And the Democrats say to themselves, well, we have the black vote, so this isn't a concern of ours. And
now, mentioning Richard Nixon, mm-hmm. 1960, Richard Nixon ran and lost. Mm-hmm. He could not carry the black vote. Mm-hmm. 1964, Goldwater discovered the Southern strategy. Mm-hmm. 1968, Richard Nixon implemented the Southern strategy mm-hmm. and won. And since 1968, we have had a Southern strategy. And right now, in my opinion, mm-hmm. we're looking at a modified Southern strategy, et cetera, and so forth. Now, where is this Southern strategy going to take the Republican Party? One, and two, most crucially, mm-hmm. did blacks leave the party voluntarily, or were they driven out of the party by policies and issues associated with the new Southern strategy?
Well, I think that it was clear in, say, 1964 that Lyndon Johnson was much better for black America than was Barry Goldwater. Johnson had recently passed the 1964 Civil Rights Act and had asserted himself as friendly to black interests. And I think that, that blacks in 1964 were sent a message that they weren't necessarily, that the Republican Party wasn't going to do anything for them to try and win back their votes.
Well, where is the impetus today for blacks to join the Republican Party?
Well, I think the impetus has to be based on economics. In 1964, there were still the legal barriers to equality, and until an office holder or a candidate was willing to address those concerns, it made sense to go to the party that was willing to break down those barriers. But today, when I think the barriers are economic in nature, Blacks should be looking to the party that is offering economic advancement. The Republican Party, during the 1980s, had a clear record on that front, and I think that it's one that should be looked at more seriously.
Yeah, not only was that economic opportunity provided for Blacks during the 1980s, but during 1968, for example, when Richard Nixon came into power. Now, it is very, very difficult for Blacks to receive economic opportunity. After being socialized to depend on the Great Society programs of the 60s, these programs, in my opinion, only entrap the motivation for Blacks to do for themselves. Now, when Richard Nixon came into power, Blacks were so dependent on these social programs for their survival until they missed the economic opportunity that Richard Nixon opened up. For example, he created something what we call Black capitalism, okay? And for those Blacks during that era who were fortunate enough to see this opportunity and seize those opportunities and became very, very rich Black men and Black women during that time. In fact, there was a great dinner that we put on for Richard Nixon in 1984, and you would be surprised of the Blacks that showed up who benefited from that Black capitalism program that Richard Nixon instituted. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, we have to dislodge ourselves from these democratic social welfare programs. There are traps in themselves, okay? We need to endorse a Republican philosophy of self-help. We had that at one time.
Right. I think you're absolutely right, and I think that what was most important about the economic gains made in the 1980s was that they were, you're talking about private sector job initiatives. It wasn't dependency on the government, and in order for these economic barriers to be broken down, it's going to have to be through the private sector. The jobs can't be provided by the government.
Mr. Reeves, you point out in your book, and I'd like to say this with regard to self-help. Mm-hmm. Self-help is not a Republican invention. During slavery and every period of severe repression of Blacks, Blacks have resorted
Absolutely.
To self-help. Booker T. Washington did not create self-help. The Black community demanded a leader that advocated self-help because they had their backs, the whole country turned its backs on.
Absolutely.
And you point this out in an article you wrote in an analysis, Booker T. Washington, Clarence Thomas, et al. So I got it in there.
Yeah.
So I'd just like to say, when we say self-help, we're talking about a tradition that is not a Republican tradition. It's a tradition of Black people. Right ahead, sir.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to know, what is the Republican Party going to do at this point to now so much stem the tide? Because looking and listening to what I see on television in regard to what the Republican platforms are, I personally wouldn't feel comfortable voting for them or even putting any of them in office.
Sure.
What are they going to do so that I would feel comfortable not just for me, in the Black community in general? What are they going to do for the Black community so that we can feel comfortable about voting for them?
Well, I've said it over and over, but I think it's a message that needs to be repeated, and I think it's the message has to be economic opportunity, and that the Republican Party has a clear record of economic expansion, and that is the way. If the Black population wants to advance, it's going to be through economics. There is a great concern with things like Willie Horton and quotas and Jesse Helms and David Duke, all of which are affiliated with the Republican Party, creates this perception of the Republican Party as somehow anti-Black, and clearly that is not true. And I think one just has to ask oneself, what's more important, economic advancement or how the media portrays the Republican Party representing the interests of Blacks? The perception is great, and those barriers have to be broken down. But I just think an assessment of what's really important needs to be made.
The emphasis that I hear right now, I'm having a little bit of a problem with. I hear us emphasizing economic development, economic strength. I live in an all-African community, and I see where we don't have basic human rights. We're increasing with young men going to jails. We're increasing with unemployment. There's so many things that are eroding. They aren't there for us. I hear the emphasis being stressed incorrectly. My feeling is that instead of pretending we're trying to be accepting either party, we should try to form our own party right now, our own individual party, either supporting mm-hmm. our African parties, our African political systems mm-hmm. that I feel would be the best advantage in doing the things for us, rather than trying to be accepted to either one of these systems that I'm being discussed today.
Let me ask you. Come
here. I want to ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
If it is a strategy of some people in the Republican Party, strategy, to keep people, black people, out of the Republican Party,
mm-hmm.
if we do form a third party, would we be not just stepping right into their trap?
If depending on who is forming the party, there are parties we have available now.
I'm just talking about numbers, just sheer numbers. In other words, if all of us remain the Democratic Party,
mm-hmm.
and then some of us form a third party, a black
mm-hmm.
party,
mm-hmm.
but none of us go into the Republican Party,
mm-hmm.
the Republicans will still be free to mm-hmm. create issues and pander
mm-hmm.
to people who basically are afraid of black people.
Mm-hmm. But the emphasis is still not being met. We're still not being satisfied. I mean, there's nothing changing in our communities by going that route. There has to be another route that has to be taken because it's not being satisfied now for us as a people. We have to find some other option available.
Okay, thank you. All right. Mr. Rees, there was a period, I think, in the right after Lyndon Johnson in which civil rights organizations pretty much had run out of steam. And then there was a period when the Great Society, I read your book and I'm a little vague on it. Mm-hmm. Help me say what I'm trying to say.
Sure. What happened was, following passage of the Civil Rights Act in 1964 and the Voting Rights Act in 1965, the legal goals of the civil rights movement had been achieved. And there was a question in the leadership as to, well, what is to be done now? We have achieved these goals that we set out to achieve. What happened was that the civil rights movement was transformed from an opportunity-based crusade that was based on opening up access for blacks to get jobs, not to have jobs, but simply to open up the opportunity. And so you went from an opportunity-based crusade to a results-based crusade in which the leaders of the civil rights movement began to demand that statistical results occur, or that X number of blacks be hired for certain positions, and it widened the gap between the black leadership and the Republican Party, because the Republican Party was not willing to submit to these demands, whereas Lyndon Johnson did get behind them and in the process managed to push many more blacks into the Democratic Party.
Well, personally, what I think is that as African-American people, Hispanic people, we need to not so much vote Democratic line or Republican line. We need to look at the individuals, no matter what party they belong to, and see what they are going to do for us as
mm-hmm.
a people.
Mm-hmm.
And then from that, that's how we cast our vote. And I think that if we start to do that,
mm-hmm.
the Democrats would not be so sure of themselves in terms of thinking that we're going to automatically vote for them.
Absolutely.
And that would give the Republicans the message that they're going to have to offer us something, because they know that we may not vote
Absolutely.
For them.
Absolutely. I think that, I don't think that 9 out of 10 blacks over the past 25 years have agreed with every single Democratic presidential candidate, but that's what the vote totals show. And I think if black voters do what you have just said black voters should do, it won't be 9 to 1. It might be half and half. I don't exactly know what the figures would be, but you're absolutely right. It would spur a competition for black votes by the two parties that would force the candidates and the office holders to take positive action on race-related matters.
Mr. Rees, let me ask you the tough question. All good intentions notwithstanding, on the part of the Republicans, aren't the Republicans? Isn't the Republican Party fairly married to the Southern strategy? It is producing white votes, and there are more white votes than black votes.
Mm-hmm.
And this strategy has gotten the Republicans the White House, and they now
mm-hmm.
keep the White House with this strategy.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible that they could give up this emphasis on quotas? And everything is a quota.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we can discuss
sure.
quotas, but
sure.
everything black people want is not a quota.
Sure. Sure.
And they're using quotas, and then the Willie Horton, and then there's the PC Brigade.
Mm-hmm.
Everything blacks want to get rid of races in curricula suddenly is called politically correct. We're derided in every way, and these buzzwords mm-hmm. keep coming up. Now, we all know who's using these buzzwords, and we know that many whites who are in economic trouble have blamed it on the black population, because that's what these buzzwords tell them.
Mm-hmm.
Not that the economy is in bad shape mm-hmm. or that the government has mismanaged our money, but
right.
black people took your job.
Right.
Can they give up that strategy? If they give it up, would they not then lose the white vote? And if they lost the white vote, wouldn't they lose the White House?
Well, what I think needs to be done, the bottom line is they are not going to relinquish the Southern strategy, because it's been shown in every election since 1964 that it works, and if it works, don't fix it. And what has to be done is to make, I think, a Southern strategy has very negative connotations to it. I don't think you can assert that a Southern strategy is inherently racist. What I think needs to be done is a message needs to be sent to black voters that they are welcome in the Republican Party, and that there is that there are opportunities offered by Republicans that are not offered by Democrats.
The irony, if I may say, mm-hmm. we're almost out of time, to me, is that the mass migration went to the suburbs.
Mm-hmm.
Now there are more white people in the suburbs than in the cities. And if white Americans who are Republican are stigmatized as racist, they will leave the Republican Party.
Mm-hmm.
And that will stop the Southern strategy.
You're absolutely right. And I think a lot of what we're facing is breaking down some of the barriers involved with perception.
And I hate to interrupt you, I'm faced with time. Thank
sure.
you so much for
Thank
being
you.
With me.